Hello and welcome to PRSA Maryland's 5 Steps for Writing Breakthrough Byliners and Blogs. It's the top of the hour, and we are going to get started. You are listening to the voice of Peggy Hoffman. I am with PRSA Chapter as their chapter manager, and I'm going to be the tech behind the curtain today. And in keeping with that, I just want to do a couple of quick notes as we get before we get started. We are going to be using the Q&A function as well as the chat function. Some of you are already warming up your fingers on the chat. Thank you very much. Because this is an interactive presentation and we will be doing some work, you will have some exercises to play with. We're encouraging you to use the chat for submitting any and all exercises. The Q&A function allows you to post a question, and we will get to those questions as we are able. So if you've got a question, please feel free to put that in the Q&A and use the chat for any comments, questions related to each other. Any troubles, don't worry about it. You can always send the panelist or Peggy Hoffman a direct message, and we'll watch there and take care of you. Please note that when you are sending the chat for best impact, make sure you send that chat to all panelists and attendees. So you have a couple of options on that. Listen, if you want to listen again, and there will be a lot of good information here, so you might want to, the recording will be posted on the PRSA Maryland website, and the link will be in your post-session survey. So be sure to send us your feedback so we know how we've done today. Now, before I bring on our wonderful moderator and speaker, I would love to help them get to know who's on our lovely program today. And so I'm going to warm us up with a couple of quick polls. I'd like you to start by answering the question, where are you in your PR communications career? Are you a student? Are you an early careerist, mid-careerist, late careerist? Maybe you're not really in PR communications, but you want to write better, don't we all? This is an anonymous poll, so don't worry. You can call yourself a early careerist even if you're a late careerist. And by the way, those definitions are entirely up to you. There are some parts of my career I would consider myself an early careerist, and there are others that I proudly say I am a late careerist. I'm going to give you just a few more seconds to go ahead and click the button of your choice. I'm looking like we've got a nice even mix of folks on here. So that is a very cool and exciting prospect here. I'm going to give just a few more seconds here as we wind down the clock. So go ahead and click on it. And then I will show our fearless moderator and leader what we've got here. I'm going to end the poll in 3, 2, 1. And let's show what we've got here. So we have got the majority are going to be in that mid-careerist, you know, early, mid, late careerist kind of things. The biggest group that we have here is not really in PR, but they want to write better. So you are in the absolute right place. All right. One more take a look, if you would, help us out here. We'd love to get a sense of what is your like prime role when it comes to writing. Are you primarily a writer, meaning that, you know, you're getting paid to do that, or, you know, even if you're doing it on the side, right? You know, maybe you're mostly an editor and you're looking for how do you help your writers do a better job. Maybe writing is a key part of your career, not all. Maybe it's just a little piece of it. Maybe it's none of the above. And if it's none of the above, you got to tell us in the chat what brought you here, okay? Some cases, it's just an area that we really want to explore and take a look at. And for other folks, it's, you know, it's something that it pays the bills. So let us know. I can tell you that if I was adding this poll, I would say that, you know, writing is a key part of my career. I mean, I guess I spend probably more time typing in emails, if nothing else, and wouldn't a hot subject line be a great thing to learn? All right, let me give you just a few more seconds here. I'm going to end the polling in 3, 2. Oh, I see people scooting in. Okay, it's like popcorn popping. And 1, let's end the poll and let me share what we're doing. So to our wonderful speaker, you're going to see that writing is a key part of the career for most folks. And and we've actually got some folks that are really writers, primarily writers and editors. So tell us in the chat if you're the individual or individuals who said none of the above. I'm going to stop the sharing now. And it is my delight to introduce to you our moderator, Emily McDermott, who is on the board of directors for PRSA Maryland. Emily, take it over.
Well, thank you, Peggy. And on behalf of PRSA Maryland, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us from all over. We are really excited about today's program. Our speaker is Jack Appleman. He has his APR in CBC, and he's a prominent PR and business writing instructor and coach who helps people get awesome results from their writing. He's written two books so far about business writing and has been a professor for many years and now teaches at NYU. So before we kick things over to Jack, we wanted to let you know about some of our other of our upcoming events. Every week, PRSA Maryland is providing a Zoom conversation. The day of the week and time and topic vary. This week, it will be about the new COVID challenge, too many Zoom meetings and hacking the virtual meeting. Friday from 1 to 1:45, and Peggy Hoffman will be leading that Zoom. And we are also coordinating some final details for a research webinar in early May and an online reputation webinar in late May. In addition to those, we'll continue to be adding weekly Zooms to keep people in touch. So if you have any topics you'd like to hear about, any feedback, we'd love to hear back from you, and our website and social media links are there. So you can follow and get information as you'd like. So we hope you enjoy this webinar today. And without further ado, Jack, turn things over to you.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and I know that this has been a difficult time for all of us. So I just hope that you've been able to get some positives. I myself have attended a lot of webinars. I've got a lot of value from them. So hopefully I can give you some value today. So how do you get your copy to resonate with editors, other influencers, and of course the reader? Sometimes you probably feel, wow, I have great content, but the editor is ignoring me, the readers don't care about it. What do you have to do? Well, the way I look at it, you have to break on through like that old Doors song. So this is our first musical break. Hopefully you'll be able to hear this a little bit, get a start a little bit with some music. Yeah, you have to break on through to the other side. Get people to take a look at what you wrote and see why it's valuable to them. So let's continue. First of all, let me tell you a little bit about me, what I do. I help people get better results from their pitches, their releases. I help them frame the key news, client reports, help people, particularly in agencies, highlight the value they've delivered. And I help people get better results with articles and blogs, break through the clutter, what we'll be talking about today. Let's continue. I've always believed that PR in business writing is a learned skill, and that's why I decided to write this book, which is now in its second edition, 10 Steps to Successful Business Writing. So I want to know about your challenges. We have another poll question. What are your biggest challenges in writing contributed articles and blogs? So with that, we're going to put up a poll question. So which of these is your toughest challenge in writing contributed articles and blogs? Is it creating an appealing theme hasn't already been written about? Finding relevant content? Writing a captivating title and lead? Organizing the information? Or something else, which you can tell us in the chat.
Jack, we're getting some good replies. I'll let it go for just a couple more seconds here.
Terrific.
And I want to know if you're surprised by the results. We got 3, 2, 1.
Okay, well, I did think that the first one, creating an appealing theme, would be top, so that's 39%. Second, writing a captivating title and lead, okay. Then we got a tie between the relevant content and organization. And some comments, I chose other because I literally have some days where words flow and others where I can't get started. Don't we all, don't we all? All right, great. So let's continue. What are we gonna do today? Well, this is gonna be very fast paced. We're gonna do some exercises. And you're gonna do some exercises and then you're going to submit your exercises in the chat. Now, we're gonna be moving quickly. You probably think, wow, I wish I had more time for this exercise, and that's okay. Do the best you can. We have a variety of different skills. And we will try to get to all the exercises today, but we may not get to all of them. I will try to give feedback to as many people I can who submit exercises. If I haven't, feel free to email me afterwards. I will happy to give you feedback on what you wrote. And because we have a lot of people, we're gonna work in groups. So, based on the alphabetical order of your last name. So take a look now and make note of what group you're in. Group 1, last names A through D, group 2, E through M, and group 3, N through Z. Right. And also, Peggy mentioned the Q&A. I will try to get to all the questions, but again, any questions I don't get to, I'll be happy to email you after the webinar. All right, so, and again, if you want copies of the slides, please email me. I'll give you a copy of the slides. All right, let's get going. Today's topics, 1, laser focus on a single theme. Create captivating titles and leads. Loosen up your language. Craft explicit subheads. And make copy flow with smooth transitions. So 1, laser focus on a single theme. Yeah, the problem is sometimes people are just all over the place with their copy. It goes in all the different directions and it doesn't interest anyone. You have to hone in on one engaging concept, because you can't cover everything like in a press release, a fact sheet, or a case study, or whatever you're writing. Of course, you have to know your reader. What's one idea that will engage them? Not that there's only one idea, but pick one idea that you believe will engage your reader. So let's say that your target audiences are human resource professionals, and maybe you're going after an article in HR Magazine or a blog in Human Resources Today. How about these themes? Promoting ethics in organizations. Compensation promotion issues faced by today's employees. Navigating the post-COVID-19 landscape. What do you think about these themes? Feel free to submit in the chat quickly. What do you think about these themes? Give people about 30 seconds to comment any comment. You think these are good themes? Very broad, absolutely. Any other comments? Yep, 2 is definitely a current issue. Timely, all right. Anyone else? Redundant, all right. All right, so in my opinion, these themes would not get the attention because they are too vague, too broad, and people have heard them before already. How about the 3rd one, navigating the post-COVID-19 landscape? How many times have you heard that? Good comment. Ethics and compensation could generate controversial discussion, I should say, depending on the subtopic. Absolutely. But I think that's key, the subtopic. We have to get to that subtopic. So let's take a look at, let's take some vague themes and maybe turn them into focus themes. Promoting ethics in organizations. How about the value of an ethics hotline? Yeah. Compensation and promotion issues faced by today's employees. How employees can earn a better raises. And the last one, navigating the post-COVID-19 landscape. The future of remote work given COVID-19. With each of these, we turn them into a more narrow topic, which can be probably more appealing to an editor and ultimately the reader. Step two is to create captivating titles and leads. And this flows right from the theme. From the theme comes the title. There's some enticing titles. Why successful people never bring smartphones into meetings. Are you too clever for success? Hope not. Forget organic, use common sense to eat well. Now, let's go back to the themes that we identify for the HR audiences. Value of an ethics hotline. And let's turn them into a compelling title. Something like this. Are ethics hotlines effective? How employees can earn better raises? A more catchy title would be, talk yourself into a bigger raise. The future of remote work given COVID-19. Will remote work continue post-pandemic? See, what we're doing is we're using the second person. We're speaking directly to the reader. And in most cases with a contributed article or a blog, you want to speak directly to the reader. Okay, we come to our first exercise. Find a captivating theme and craft a title. So this, again, this is only for people in G1, in group one. So what I want you to do is take a look at this paragraph, and this is from a KPMG white paper. Come up with a title of a contributed article or a blog for that matter. So right, again, I want everybody to do the exercise, but only people who are in group one to submit it through the chat window. And I'll try to comment on as many as possible. All right, so let's take a few minutes. It's 18 after the hour. Let's regroup at about 1:21. And again, you probably need more time, but do the best you can in these few minutes. Again, you're looking for a compelling title. And again, keep it, you want it narrowly focused as possible. You don't want it too broad. very interested to see the submissions, because you can certainly go in different directions here. Okay, we're starting to get some submissions, so let me read some of them. How to tailor your workforce for a digital transformation. Great. Positioning your business into the digital era. Very good. Both speaking directly to the reader. All right, any other submissions? Focus on flexibility to succeed in the new normal. Very good. The end of the office. All right. I love the different approaches. The end of the office. There you go. Your employees are now your customers. If you started with flip, your employees are now your customers. Great. All right. I love these. Love these submissions. All very creative. And now let me continue, and I'll show you some other possibilities. Stop fitting workers into organizational chart structures. Treat employees as customers. Very similar to what I've seen in the chat window. All right, again, feel free throughout, ask questions. I will answer questions as I get them, and I'll have Peggy and Emily help me track the questions. All right, so let's continue. So from title to the lead, you need that 1-2 punch. The title grabs attention. The lead makes your story come alive. Let's take an example. The title is A Former FBI Negotiator and How to Build Rapport Over Video. Very straightforward title. The lead, you think pitching a new client over remote video during quarantine is tough? Try diffusing a shootout via 6 a.m. cold call. So here, we're just building on a, you see how the lead builds on the title. And let's get, I'm gonna go back. We have another submission for the title. Employees are not just a hired help anymore. All right, very good. Okay, so again, back to this. It's, you want the lead to complement the title. All right, let's keep it going. Step 3 is to loosen your language. You want to be conversational. You'll still be professional. It doesn't matter if you're in the banking, the insurance, the accounting business, so-called formal businesses. You still need to talk to people and talk to them directly. A lot of people in all my PR and business writing workshops, they've told me, hey, Jack, my company is a formal company. You don't want to write stuffy copy just to be more professional. You still want to be conversational. And that's the way people want to be spoken to. That's how they want to read articles. Remember, you're competing for attention. You need to speak to them directly. In most cases, you want to use the second person, as all of you have been doing in your submissions. The you. Let's compare these leads. In today's business world, cyber threats have become commonplace. As a result, many employers are looking for engineers with cybersecurity skills. It's decent, right? Pretty good lead. But what if you said this? Have you ever considered a career in hacking? Which one gets the attention, right? So coming up with these is just, you have to do a little personal brainstorming or brainstorming with a group and think, what's going to appeal to the reader, to the editor? And take a look at some of the other articles out there. You'll probably get some good ideas from that. Okay, so exercise 3A is to generate a compelling lead. Okay, this is for group two. So you want to write a lead to complement this headline. The headline is, are you putting on the quarantine 15, having to do with people who are isolated, just eating a lot. All right, so here's some of the issues. The stress of COVID-19 isolation, craving high sugar, high fat foods as short-term tranquilizers, contributes to health problems and anxiety. You want to break the cycle with stress-reducing activities such as yoga, meditation, exercise, and eat better. So what kind of lead would complement this headline? Are you putting on the quarantine 15? A lot of different directions you can go in. So let's take a few minutes. Everyone in group two, everyone do it. Everyone in group two, submit it through the chat box. It's 26 after the hour. So let's regroup in about 4 minutes. So right about 30 minutes after the hour. Again, you don't need to, you don't have to have all these three bullets in your lead. Just pick something that you believe would get people's attention and would build on that headline. When you look at this, obviously the quarantine 15 is a takeoff on the freshman 15, people going to college for the first time gaining weight. So who knows if it's actually true, but it certainly appears that way. Okay, we got some submissions coming in, so let me read them. Coping with everyday stress seems different now. But is it really? All right, great. You may want to get in the fact related to the weight gain there. Next one. Your list of to-dos and to try under stay-at-home orders may be growing along with your waistline. All right, with the waist, growing with the waistline. Feet very nicely with the quarantine 15. All right. It's time for more submissions. COVID-15, pivot to make it strength training. Three ways. Good. You may want a little bit more of a bridge to talk about the weight gain and then talk about the pivot there. Shift the weight of being quarantined into empowering your mind, body, and soul so 15 becomes a new transformation. Okay, all right, so keep them coming. Got time for some more submissions. And again, I realize that you could probably come up with others if you had more time. So I appreciate those of you who are very quick to submit. But again, just get your ideas out there. I'll tell you what, I'll open up to anyone. Any other groups, anyone in the other groups want to submit, go ahead and do so. People are self-soothing with high fat and sugary foods to cope with the stress of COVID. Here's what to do instead. Very good. Very, very direct. Yeah, submit what you're noodling on. Submit your ideas. Yeah, sometimes when you write, what I find when I'm working with people, tell people, well, write it out and let's see how it reads. All right. Any others? Anyone else wanna submit a lead to, are you putting on the quarantine 15? Do all the things you already know you should be doing to combat the stress of COVID-19 and unwanted weight gain. All right. You need a better transition to get from the title to the lead there. Okay. Have you asked yourself the question, why am I gaining weight? You're not alone. Here are some tips on how to stay fit and healthy through COVID-19. Good. You probably can go right to why am I gaining weight on that one. You don't have to sit around and gain. Let's talk about how to get up, all right? Interesting, good. High sugar, high fat foods are nothing but short-term tranquilizers. During an unprecedented time, anxiety is on the rise, and so are the unhealthy habits that follow. All right, great. So here's one I came up with. If you keep downing those taste-so-good snacks to cope with COVID-19 isolation, you could soon be paying the price with poor physical and mental health. Right? And here's one more. If being quarantined has you feeling anxious, your diet may not be helping. All right, very good. I think some of the ones I've gotten are better than the ones I came up with. Are you watching your waistline spread as the rumors of COVID-19 spread? Get up and move to avoid the COVID-19. Great, love it. All right, let's continue. Step four is to create explicit leads. You want to get people to ask you to tell me more. And here comes our next musical break. Have to fast forward this a little bit. Okay, that's what you want to do. You want to get people to want you to tell them more about the subject. It's writing explicit subheads that lure the reader in. So let's take a look at some dull versus tell me more subheads. The importance of being positive with technology. Shift your mindset. Again, shift your mindset is talking directly to the reader. Outcomes are more important than technology. And what I should say is this was from a blog from Casey about the top 20 tech tips for teachers. Okay? So instead of outcomes are more important than technology, start with the why. Recognizing students' technological expertise. How about don't be afraid to let students teach you, right? So what you're doing with these type of subheads, with each of these, is when you're the reader, you say, yeah, tell me more. I want to learn more about this. Based on the explicit subhead, again, you lure readers in. So let's give it a shot. Let's create some tell me more subheads. We'll go with the people from group 3. So over here, what I want you to do is, you can pick either one of these. You can pick either number 1 or number 2. I'll tell you what, let's get everybody involved in this. So if you are in group 1, I want you to write a subhead for number 1. If you're in group 2 or 3, write a subhead for number 2. All right, so let's give this a shot. And again, remember, keep it in the second person, make it engaging, make me want to say, hey, tell me more about this. So again, let's get anyone in group one, you do number one. Groups two, group three, do number two. Let's create a subhead for that paragraph. All right, it's 35 after the hour. Let's go about 3 or 4 minutes. And again, I should say the title. The title is, Can COVID-19 Impact Your Ability to Get a Job? Okay, let's take a look. Nailing the video interview, great. Virtual interviews are the new norm, or virtual interviews on the rise. Great, that's for number one. Jobs are won and lost on LinkedIn. You may want to turn that into you can win or lose a job on LinkedIn to make it more for the second person. Practice your screen presence. Okay. I might say perfect your screen presence there. Ready to brand yourself or step back to level up? Good. All right. Any others? Got a couple of minutes? Again, either number one or number two. Find out how enhancing your online appearance could help you land your dream job. Great. You might want to turn that one is enhance your profile, land your dream job. Why you? Create a compelling LinkedIn profile that gets you in the door and lands the job. Good. Use your extra time to revamp your personal brand. Is your resume and LinkedIn profile pandemic ready? Here are 6 ways you can improve your job prospects in a future where employment has moved online. Wow, you took it to the lead and the next step, and it flows very well. Take your resume to the next level. Why your LinkedIn profile is critical to getting employers' attention. Getting a job is stressful at any time, let alone a pandemic. How to make the right virtual impression. Okay. Yeah, so I think a lot of you, what you did here is you kind of wrote very good leads. So we're looking for subheads, but so what? You wrote some great leads. So the question was, is there a target length for a subhead? Yeah, you want it better if you keep your subhead shorter. I have seen longer subheads. Sometimes when you really want to get the point across, they're a little longer. But if you can get the point across with fewer words, it's better. All right, so let's take a look at some of these potential subheads. First of all, here's number one, and this was actually published. Get really good at virtual interviewing. I like some of the submissions better than this one. Number two, focus on your personal brand. Again, I like some of what you guys submitted better. The point is, you want to figure out what's going to be a subhead that gets people to say, hey, tell me more about it. Tell me more. And I do recommend subheads because nowadays, and I'm sure you all use subheads already, but people like information in short chunks. And there's nothing like, I find that as a writer, I like to use subheads, and as a reader, I like reading copy better with subheads. All right, let us continue. Step five is to make your copy flow. Yeah, we have a question.
Jack, can I, we just had somebody was interested in understanding better, it's something, how long something is and the rule of thumb in terms of when do you use subheads, when don't you use subheads? And then there's a follow-up question is, if the title is a question, would you avoid making the subhead a question as well? So okay. Two questions there. It's kind of like, how do I know when to use subheads, heads, and then do I need to vary it?
Yeah. Well, the question of when to use subheads is a judgment call. Most of these contributor articles and blogs use subheads because, again, people like things in small chunks. After you have the title, you don't want to have a subhead right away. You want to have a lead in a paragraph which frames the article, and then you need to have a transition to the first subhead, which I'll talk about in a couple of minutes. I hope that answers that question. So the other question regarding the length of the subheads and whether you have a question. If the title is a question, again, you wouldn't go right from the title to the subhead. If the subhead itself is a question, and then the first sentence after the subhead, it can be a question, but just, you don't wanna have too many questions. At some point, maybe a couple in a row gets people to think. But after a while, you have to start answering the question start making your points. All right, did I answer the person's question? All right, I'll assume that's a yes. Feel free to ask a follow-up question if you want more clarity. So the next step is to make your copy flow with smooth transition. It's just what we talked about, from the title to the lead to the body. And here's a little jazz music to get you in tune with making your copy flow. I often listen to jazz music to try to get myself in the mood. I'm a big believer in that music helps people write better. All right, so you want to make sure your copy flows. How do we make sure our copy flows? From the lead to the body, you need that bridge. Let's take an example. Article from Entrepreneur, 6 Timeless Strategies That Drive Successful Entrepreneurship. The lead, in today's ever-changing business climate, an entrepreneur can easily become overwhelmed. The bridge, it's vital though to stay focused on your goals for the company. The body, even with a firm strategy, every entrepreneur should do these 6 things to clear a path to success. So again, you have the lead, and it, sometimes, of course, they're longer than this. The body is really, in many articles and blogs, it's about 6 this or 6 that, so you're gonna have the subheads for each of those. But you need that bridge to get from the lead to the body. All right, so let's take a look at an exercise in which you're gonna have to do just that. Okay. And for this, we're gonna have the people from G3. You get first dibs on submitting, but then if we have more time, we'll let everyone submit. All right, so here is the lead. When it comes to clothes shopping, not wasting money is just as important as finding that special bargain. Too often we purchase things we don't need, never wear, or are expensive to maintain. The body is, see these tips for maximizing your shopping dollar. This is from Smart Money. So what you need to do here is you need to create the bridge. What's the bridge? Maybe it's one sentence or so that creates a smooth transition from the lead to the body. All right, let's take a few minutes for this. Again, the people from G3, you get first dibs on submitting. And then everyone else, I'll tell you when you could submit, depending on how many we have. 45 after the hour, let's go about 4 minutes. Okay, we're getting some submissions, so let me start reading them. To help you find a balance, we've made a list to help you stay frugal and get great deals on the clothes you need. Great. If this seems like your shopping habits, then learn ways to spend less for more by following these tips. So the key is to thread the needle. So to speak, focus on what you need and get the biggest bang for your buck. Great. So the first couple kind of took the body and expanded it to create that transition. This last one was really the bridge. So the key is to thread the needle. Here's how to buy clothes on a budget. Great. So I'll let everybody submit now. Any group you'd like to submit. It's time to stop shopping your feelings away. Ah, love it. Love it. What's any other ideas on the bridge from the lead to the body? Make sure you make smart purchases. There you go. These are some things to keep in mind on your next shopping trip to avoid these mistakes. I like what I'm seeing because in a lot of cases, you can go from the lead to the body just with an extra sentence or two. So some of you are doing a very good job with that. To help manage your spending habits, see these tips. Often we buy emotionally without thinking about it, whether we really need something. So the next time you're shopping, ask yourself how you will justify the item, and follow these tips to reduce the lure of the sale. Great. Put an end to impulsive spending while remaining one of the stylish kids of the block. There you go. That's speaking to, love it, directly to the reader. Now, these are all subjective. We all have different styles. All right, take another minute or two. Anyone else has an idea? How do we bridge it? Seen some different approaches. All right, so let's continue. I'm still gonna look. Anyone has some submissions? I'll still take a look at them. Now I'll show you the actual bridge used in the story. That's not the actual bridge. Let me go to the next one. Smart clothes shopping starts with a plan for your wardrobe, considers the cost of owning each one. All right, great. So I didn't even give you anything about smart clothes shopping or the plan, and you were able to come up with some very, very well-written bridges, and you took the body, you incorporated your own way of getting into the eight tips. Right, anyone have any questions on this? Comments or questions? All right, any comments or questions, anything we've done so far? All right, let's continue. Okay, we're gonna recap what we've done today. We've talked about laser focusing on a single theme, creating captivating titles and leads, loosening up your language, crafting explicit subheads, and making copy flow with smooth transitions. All right, if you could tell me what was your most important takeaway today? I'd love to hear about what you got out of this, maybe how you can use it in your job or in your schoolwork. Love to hear what your most important takeaway is.
And Jack, while we're waiting for some folks to jump in there, we've got a question. It says, you mentioned for a few of the bridges that some submissions seem like extended leads or others felt like actual bridges. Can you just go a little deeper in how you differentiate between the bridge and the extended lead?
Sure. Well, in a lot of cases, the lead, sometimes just a question of separating the paragraphs into shorter paragraphs. But if we take a look at some of the submissions that we just got, for example, we had one submission. If this seems like your shopping habits, then learn ways to spend less for more value by following these tips. That was one where it's an extended lead, which goes right into the tips. Another one, which is really like a bridge, which offers more information is, there were a couple of good ones. Often we buy emotionally without thinking about it, whether we really need something. Okay. So that sentence is the bridge and then into the body. So the next time you're shopping, ask yourself how you will use the item and follow these tips. So I hope that answers your question, Ryan. But the bottom line is there are a lot of ways to do it. And I suggest that just pay attention to the way some of the blogs and the articles you like and see which ones work for you. Okay, so let's take a look at some of the comments. I like the emphasis on the laser focus, absolutely. And I had a feeling that would be in the poll question, what people would respond to the most. Using subheadings more, thinking about what the reader wants, gets from the story, information in short chunks, strong words, a couple of the second person. Love that loosen up language. Subheads make it more skimmable. Capturing your audience so they say, tell me more. Okay. Great review for being more intentional and organized with writing. Okay. Having a compelling focus theme that engages. Okay. Staying organized. Using the second person more in subheads. Okay. All right. Yes, and anyone wants some ideas to work and wants some ideas or feedback, that would be great as well. All right. So keep submitting, so that we have a few minutes. And just want to tell you about the partnership between Successful Business Writing and PRSA's Maryland chapter. We have a value-added coaching program, which includes a 60-minute virtual writing consult with me, and that can be divided into two 30-minute consults. access to 19 of my 5-minute writing tutorials, 6 months, a copy of my book, and this will be available $179 for members and $229 for non-members. This is a value of $325. And also, we have customized webinars and workshops when we allow people to meet in person, and coaching programs. So again, feel free to contact me. Anybody wants more information, email me directly. There's my email address. So anybody wants copies of the slides, email me as well. If you want to be put on my email blast list, I give writing tips 2 or 3 times a month. And again, it's really been a pleasure. I had a lot of fun today. Happy to stay to answer some questions.
Yeah, so Jack, you probably just saw the question coming in. I have the blog about cash flow for a client. Is something I could ask for feedback on.
Absolutely, yeah.
So, yeah, okay, yeah. Great.
Cash flow.
And cool. And I guess the other thing that I saw was people saying, you know, we're all so exhausted of hearing COVID-19 in the headline. I know you mentioned that earlier on. But to the question that came up about a blog about cash flow for a client, I mean, he probably has to type the word COVID-19 how many times? Any suggestions or thoughts on how we can talk about it without, you know, being just like everybody else's headlines?
Yeah.
And Brian, let us know if that answered the question.
Yeah, well, cash flow about client, I agree that there is so much, everything you see is COVID, 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 all the PR trades, how to talk to employees during COVID. We're getting tired about that. Pretty soon, people are going to want to hear information about regular parts of life. So you have to ease into it. You could even have a headline if you're like something like tired of COVID-19 information or something like, you can even use it to say you must be tired. Maybe you want to move on to this. Maybe you want to move on to a tired of COVID-19 advice. Try thinking about your, here's some cash flow. Here's some cash flow tips, something like that. Right? So yeah, it's really tricky because if you don't address it, sometimes people feel you're being insensitive. But if you do address it, it's like, oh my God, another COVID-19 comment. So you have to figure out a way to say, you want to come across as you're helping people. If you're coming across as helping people, I think you're okay. In other words, like post-pandemic financial tips, or something like that. But if you're giving people the same old thing that they've seen a million times before, then I think your copy will be ignored. And I see Ryan had a comment. I actually focused on not talking about COVID-19 to retain audience attention. Okay, great. Try to keep COVID out of evergreen content. Content is relevant today. Very good. Yep, it is very tricky. Thank you so much for all this great input, great submissions, great questions. Again, still feel free to ask more questions.
Okay, great. And thank you, Jack, for joining us. I'm going to bring Emily back in again just to give us a wrap while we're letting people go ahead and continue. Emily.
Thank you, Peggy, and thank you, Jack. Thanks, everyone, for joining us here today. We hope that this was a helpful, informational, inspiring webinar. Jack has a lot of great resources, so please be sure to check out the offerings that he is giving out today to everyone. And like we said earlier, please stay updated with the organization, PRSA Maryland, for upcoming events. And as a reminder, you will get a link with the recording from today's webinar, along with a survey so you can give feedback and tell us what other events and topics you're interested in. So please watch out. That email will come from info@prsamd.org. Sometimes it gets stuck in the spam. So please check there, and so the recording today will be available to you in that email. And with that, we will wrap it up. Thank you again to Jack for presenting, Peggy for hosting, and all of you for attending today. Have a great day, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.